はいはい。
Good evening, everyone. Please be seated. Yeah, right. Deputy Lord Lieutenant, Lords and Ladies, past Mayors, Mayoresses and Consorts, existing free persons of the Royal Borough of Greenwich, the Archdeacon and Reverends, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome to this special meeting of the Council, which has been called to award the Freedom of the Borough to five notable individuals. Please understand that the meeting is being filmed and will be uploaded to the Council's website tomorrow. You are also welcome to film the meeting, but we do insist on no flash photography to avoid disrupting the proceedings. Having said that, can we now then move to item one, which is apologies for absence. I have received apologies from the following councillors for absence. Councillors Olu Babatola, Christine Grice, Denise Scott-McDonald, Jackie Smith, Sarah Merrill, Nuala Geary and Matt Clare. Are there any other apologies to be recorded? No, thank you. Going to now move to item two, Mayor's announcements. Can I first say, given the tragic events in Brussels on Tuesday, I would like to ask all present to stand and hold a minute's silence in memory of those horrifically murdered or injured in the latest terrorist outrage to hit Europe. There will be many Belgians living in our borough, and at times like this, I know that support from other countries does help them in their hour of need. So perhaps I could ask you to rise for a minute's silence. Thank you. Thank you. Can I say that a Belgian flag will be hung at half mast outside the town hall from tomorrow, and you probably noticed the Union Jack is hung at half mast even as we speak. The second announcement is a much more pleasant one. I'd just like to congratulate Eltham Hill School on winning the World Book Day prize of £20,000, which they have wisely spent on the refurbishment of their library. So having said that, can we now move to item three, which is declarations of interest. Could members please indicate now if they have any interest in any of the items of business on the agenda? I see none. Item four, award Freedom of the Borough. As you're well aware, tonight we're awarding the Freedom of the Borough to five individuals who have served their community with distinction. Should the Council agree to the awards, It will represent the high civic honour that the council can bestow. Whilst the award no longer brings with it the benefit of grazing sheep on Woolwich Common, although I have to say that the prospect of grazing sheep on Woolwich Common for the first time in 150 years has much to commend it, it is nevertheless an achievement and recognition in its own right. The award also reflects well on the borough that individuals of such merit continue to live and serve the local community. In relation to each award, I will be asking for the nomination to be moved and seconded, and I will then ask members of the council only to vote. Please note that on each occasion, a two-thirds majority will be required. So, firstly, can we move, and can I ask Councillor Spencer Drury if he would like to come up and move the recommendation that former Councillor Dermot Poston, JP, MBE, is awarded the Freedom of the Borough. Councillor Drury.
Am I speaking to anything in particular? Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me enormous pleasure to propose Dermot Poston receive the Freedom of the Borough this evening. Dermot is richly deserving of this award due to his long and distinguished public service. Over the last 50 years, Dermot has served residents across South East London as a councillor, a magistrate, a teacher. Indeed, so highly respected is he that in 2013 he was awarded the MBE. But this award tonight is really linked to Dermot's service as a councillor. He was first elected in 1968 as one of the members for Horne Park Estate. I hesitate to say which is the greater achievement, being elected in 1968 or being a Conservative elected as a councillor for the Horne Park Estate. And those of us involved in politics locally, I think, can imagine what an enormous achievement that was. In those first few years, Dermot served as part of the only Conservative administration that this borough has ever known. He served as the chairman of the Leisure Services Committee, which at that time ran sport and culture within the borough. I'm sure there are many highlights for Dermot from this time, but my favourite story is about him giving permission for the first ever nudist swimming competition at Plumstead Baths. To my knowledge, it's the only time such an event has ever been held in the borough, and I like to think Dermot bore the questions about where to pin the prizes with his normal good humour. Over the following few years, Dermot continued to serve the people of the borough of Greenwich as a representative for New Eltham, for Eltham Park, and most recently for Eltham North Ward. As a Conservative in Greenwich, Dermot has lost elections, but I think that these setbacks have made him stronger, and by the time I was elected in 2002, he was already established as the elder statesman of the Conservative group, and in many ways, the council as a whole. What I found personally most impressive about Dermot was his patience and his tolerance, especially to someone like me who had no idea what they were doing. I'd never been to a council meeting before I was elected. I got used to the gentle hand on the shoulder at the end of a council meeting with that question, "So how do you think that went, Spence?" Obviously, Dermot had the answer, but I always appreciated his gentle honesty when pointing out how dreadfully wrong I'd got something yet again. I'm not sure I can do justice to Dermot's style as a councillor, but Councillor Freeman and I were discussing it earlier on, and I think I would describe it as populist. Whenever there was a group of people unhappy about something the council had done, Dermot had a wonderful knack for giving a short speech summarising their concerns and sitting down to a rousing round of applause and cheers. Whatever the cause, Dermot could give residents a voice that they needed on the council or the planning committee, and I saw him receive great support on issues ranging from the redevelopment of Greenwich Market through to the appalling state of the lifts at Sowerby Close. It is something many of us have tried to copy, but I have to say it's a unique talent and something I've come to admire. Dermot has served many organisations within the community. He's the longest serving trustee of Eltham United Charities. He was on the board of Greenwich Theatre for many years and helped bring Sevendrew Castle back into use as one of the trustees. In short, his contribution as a councillor was seldom limited to the council chamber itself, and his passion for helping residents never slackened over all those years. In my opinion, it is a sign of the enormous respect in which Dermot is held that when we held a dinner for his retirement from the council, with all funds raised going to Sevendrew Castle, the current MP Clive Efford and his predecessor Peter Bottomley both found the time to attend. It was a lovely evening, with real respect for Dermot's personality and work shining through from all present. To bring this to a conclusion, Dermot's contribution to the borough has been magnificent. He remains one of the nicest people I've met in politics and blends empathy for the problems of local residents with an ability to see the bigger picture and place the needs of the borough before the requirements of party politics. Dermot is a richly deserving recipient of the Freedom of the Borough. I'd like to thank everyone here, most notably Leader of the Council, for agreeing to confer it upon him. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to second this particular nomination. Dermot Potson's contribution to the Royal Borough of Greenwich has been long and immense, particularly in the fields of education and planning. His contributions in debates in the council chamber have been thought-provoking and received in silence and respect from his fellow councillors, not only on the Conservative side, but also on the Labour side. You may not have agreed with him, but you did respect what he had to say and you listened to what he had to say. His contribution to planning, especially development control, and preserving historic buildings of the Royal Borough of Greenwich has been immense. He's been instrumental in helping to preserve many listed buildings in our borough in the face of strong opposition from developers, and I have absolutely no hesitation in seconding the recommendation. So therefore, can I now ask Council to vote on the recommendation that former Councillor Dermot Potson, JP, MBE, is awarded Freedom of the Borough. All those in favour, please raise their hand. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hands. I see none. Abstentions, I see none. I'm therefore pleased to declare the recommendation agreed. I would therefore like to invite Dermot Potson to receive his award and to say a few words. Dermot, please come forward.
Many thanks to you, Mr. Mayor, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished visitors, and particularly many thanks to you, Spencer, whom I've known for some time now, and we have been very good friends. I'd like to make a comment about the nude bathing. If I may. It was a wonderful evening, but there was one problem connected with it, which was that when my wife and I went to pin the medals on the winners, we found that very difficult. You'll probably understand what I mean. I count it, Mr. Mayor, a great honor to be here today. Nearly 50 years after I was elected as a councillor in 1968. But before that election, I was very arrogant about it all, very conceited, and I was determined that I was going to put everyone right, particularly the Labour councillors, and get them properly sorted out. But because I'd hoped I would be, an eloquent backbencher who would be there, not having to do anything himself, but just be criticizing other people. But the reality was very, different. Very different indeed. To start with, I found myself a member of the conservative group. And, you know, the conservative majority. I should add, it was the first for many years, and there's never been one since. And as a cabinet member, think of that, me, a young chap, and I was made a cabinet member, you know, with a budget of over £1 million, I really found myself having to behave myself, especially with various officers trailing me around, and one even turning up at the school where I was teaching. That was a bit poor, wasn't it? Over the years, there have been some remarkably interesting people on the council, quite apart from Spencer Drury, who is remarkable by anybody's standards. But we had Ian Davidson, you won't remember him, a very remarkable man who became the executive and the chairman of Lloyd's of London, one of our councillors. And we had Paul Batterbury, who became a very distinguished judge. Very nice man. And Arthur Capelin, who was the leader of the Labour group. I remember Arthur with great affection. He was leader of the Labour group when I was leader of the Conservative group, then in opposition. And of course, we both had unsheathed daggers about our persons. But strange as it may seem, we admired each other enormously. And so I think of people like that. I also think of people like Professor King. I associate him with the council. And I think of Chris Roberts, who is here tonight. Remarkable man, in my opinion. No matter what he said, that one almost always disagreed with. But, and of course, if I may go back to Spencer for one moment, his great achievements were those speeches he made in the council chamber, which were so extraordinarily well prepared. You know, he never spared himself on the research, and I admired that enormously. In spite of anything I may have said to him to the contrary after he'd made some of those speeches. And I want to say, as well as Mary Ney, we all know Mary, don't we? Although she's recently left us. But as well as Mary Ney, there were some remarkable officers that I recall with admiration. Particularly the man who used to sit in the chief officer's seat in the council chamber, a man called David Leggett, who was the borough librarian. A really remarkable chap whose distinction was recognized well beyond the boundaries of this borough. So I remember these people, and I'm now thinking about you and thinking about the fact that I mustn't go on too long. So finally, I would like to thank my wife for her extraordinary forbearance while all this nonsense has been going on in the Victoria Hall. So thank you for that, Jenny. And that's all, really, I wish to say to you. Good night.
Dermot, thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. We now move to the next recipient, which is former Councillor Jim Gilman. Next, can I invite Councillor Alan McCarthy to come forward and move the recommendation that past Mayor and former Councillor Jim Gilman is awarded the Freedom of the Borough.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. And may I say how delighted I am to be proposing this motion for Jim to get the freedom. Jim and I have known each other for a very long time. I was trying to think of a metaphor to describe the difference that is made by someone worthy of this great distinction. And I thought about planets which circle stars in far-off galaxies, so far away that they cannot be seen, they cannot be spotted, and yet they can be identified because of the difference they make to what's around them. And that, I thought, was the metaphor, because these candidates have all made a difference far beyond the job they do as councillors or in the mosque, etc. It's wider than that, and we can see it by the effect. Now, Jim's association with Greenwich goes back to the Second World War, when his family was sadly bombed out in Stepney and he came over to this side of the river. He wasn't there for long because they evacuated him, and in time-honoured fashion, Jim moved from Stepney to Greenwich to Wales to a school which spoke Welsh. Borrowed dar, if that wasn't the wrong time of day. Maya will correct me and tell me which is the right time of day. He came back to London and was once again moved and evacuated, this time to Blenheim. No, not the palace, not the birthplace of Churchill, seats of the Dukes of Marlborough. No, Jim got a cottage. But I'm sure it was a very interesting time for someone who came from Stepney to be in that very beautiful countryside around that part of the world. Later, he joined the Royal Signals when he did national service, and had the first opportunity he ever had to go abroad, to Hanover. I am sure it must have been interesting, and I'm sure he learned a lot. He came back, and one of his first jobs, I got told, rather alarmingly, I thought, was that he operated the guillotine. Until I was told by Janet, don't worry, it was in the print. And he worked in the print for what was it, about 40 years, wasn't it, Jim? And I think in that time he worked for the Daily Mirror until that Mr. Knight Maxwell, that lovely man, made him redundant. And he used to have conversations with Jim too. I think that's really very unfair. But I think it was in his time at the Daily Mirror that he started to get a real sense of social justice and unfairness, because he became father of the chapel there, which is actually quite a significant position. And he's been involved with the council, as you have seen from the agenda, for a very long time and in all sorts of particular ways. But I think it's for the extras that we also recognise these folk. And for Jim, the extras have always been massive involvement with the community. He's been a school governor at various schools for over 40 years. He has been involved with organisations like the Charlton Society, the Friends of Charlton Park, other parks, all sorts of bodies, but the common factor is that he helps people and seeks to correct injustice when he sees it. And I'll give you another, for instance, and this is online, you can look it up, because during his first mayoralty, the Thames Barrier Visitor Centre celebrated its 500,000th visitor. Thames News covered this. What did they show that night? Was it the beauty of the barrier, the beauty of the area, the importance of the visitor centre? No. It was the Mayor of Greenwich raising the important issue of the price of tea and coffee in the cafe. 25p and 35p respectively, which probably actually was a lot of money at that time. So the piece that went out that night, as I say, you can see it online, was Jim being interviewed and having a cup of tea, trying to get that put right, because he'd written to Ken Livingstone about it as well. And there are other examples. That's just one over one aspect. But he always helps people. I'm indebted to Councillor Kirby, my friend, for telling me how, when they were canvassing together, they knocked on a door, and the door opened, the man answered, looked and saw Jim, said, "Oh yeah, Jim, it's all right, I'm there for you, and turned to Chris and said, "Jim got me a new gas boiler 31 years ago. He had never been forgotten." And also, there's always a canvassing story. When canvassing with John Austin, when they were both the councillors for Hornfair Ward, the door was opened by someone. They again looked across and saw Jim, said, "It's all right, I vote Labour, I've just told your father." And if you'd known John Austin in those days, you can see how the mistake might have been made. So the idea that you are John Austin's son, Jim, appeals to me enormously. And Jim's position is not just known within the boundaries of our borough. When chairing the Charlton Society, together with the chair of the then Tenants and Residents Association, Jim was deeply concerned about the burnt out pavilion in Hornfair Park and wanted something done about it. I know this because, doing my research online, I discovered the article. No, not in the Greenwich local paper, in the Argus, Brighton. I have no idea why a Brighton paper is reporting news in our part of the world other than it involved Jim. That, Mr. Mayor, is an example of Jim's service to the community, but he has, and I'll close in just a moment, with one little thought. He has a hobby, or is it a passion? Golf. I'm sure Janet is delighted, because it means he's out quite a lot every morning, providing the weather's not too bad. And I understand, Jim, you have achieved that which every golfer aims to achieve, hopes to achieve, and costs a fortune when they do achieve. You have had a hole in one. That, I think, is also worthy of giving Jim the freedom of the borough. And my last remark comes from the man himself. I found a quote given by Jim to a journal. Jim received the National Merit Award from the Labour Party in 2009. There are only two a year. It's a very significant achievement. And it was reported. And what Jim said in his interview included, the rewards of giving time and effort to the Labour Party is not for what you can get out of it yourself, but for the difference you can make for your community. We know with Jim, you can take out the two words Labour Party and put in Council or Charlton Society or any of the many, many bodies with which Jim has been so closely associated. And you know that is Jim, and that, Mr. Mayor, is my, I am so delighted to propose him for this honour. Thank you very much.
I would now like to invite Councillor Denise Highland to come forward and to second the recommendation.
Well, James John Gilman, what a privilege it is here today to second your nomination as Freeman of the Royal Borough of Greenwich. Alan McCarthy is a hard act to follow, but I shall try. Jim and Janet, our own Richard and Judy, but more successful. Jim represented the council, his wards between 1974 and 2002, and then came back for a second bite of the cherry between 2010 and 2014, and indeed represented Hornfair, Ferrier, Trafalgar, and Kidbrook with Hornfair. I first met Jim in the early 1990s when I was working in adult education as a head of department. And we were called urgently down to the Ferrier estate. I don't know whether you remember this, Jim, when a company was making a series for BBC television called Behind the Lines. It was a police drama series. And quite insensitively, they had daubed the entire adult education centre on the outside with racist graffiti. They had taken no due care and attention to avoid a problem in the community. Sadly, the very next day, a young black man took his own life, and people conflated these two tragedies. There was absolute unrest in the community, as you could imagine, and going down to the centre, I found a couple of hundred people quite het up and up in the air, as you can imagine. And there in the middle, calming the whole situation down, was Councillor Jim Gilman. And you could see the respect that the community had for him. It was completely, completely palpable. You know, Jim was always in tune with his residents, always working hard for their betterment. He was a role model to a lot of us, and I personally benefited, Jim, from your advice. One new councillor said that Jim showed him by example how to do the job. They were there out canvassing one day when there were some hoodie youths on the corner, and people were wondering quite whether there was going to be a problem. And Jim marched straight over to them, no messing, friendly and fatherly advice, straight in at the deep end. He knew how to, oh, he still do know how to talk to people, Jim. And what I love about Jim is a wonderful sense of humour, but he doesn't suffer fools gladly either. Jim, you have a really proud history here, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, the list is just endless of the number of committees that you have chaired, that you have vice-chaired, all the years that you've done those. And I'm just going to pick out a few. Housing, you've given an awful lot of your time to the concerns around housing. Indeed, you voted against the sale of council houses. Area planning committees, direct labour services. You could almost say that we wouldn't have GS Plus if the work that had been done in the council by yourself and Chris Roberts and others on direct labour, and Peter Brooks, all of you worked hard to make that happen. Environment, equalities, finance, chair of highways, housing, which I've mentioned, policy and resources, social services, as well as working with the unions and the staff consultative bodies. And you'll note that they all came here tonight to cheer you. I'm going to finish to say that you did all your work above and beyond the call of duty. You were respected as a councillor by residents, businesses, officers and members alike, Jim, and I look forward to our next round of golf. Well done. Thank you.
Can I now ask the council to vote on the recommendation that former councillor Jim Gilman is awarded the freedom of the borough? All those in favour, please raise their hand. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hand. I see none. Any abstentions? I see none. I'm therefore pleased to declare the recommendation agreed. I would now like to invite Jim to receive his award and to say a few words.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Mayor, Madam Mayoress, it is a great honour receiving this award. It is so sparingly given in this council, and rightly so. So tonight, to find myself standing here, it is a great pride I have, and thank you very much. My time on the council was a wonderful time of my life. I still miss it. I miss the ability to make some difference occasionally. But then I go to others, don't to Alan, and say, could you do this done, please? And quite often it's done, and I've got a few more to come and see you with. But just a little bit about the borough, because as Alan mentioned, we came here in the early 40s, and I went to two schools, Calvert Road and Charlton Central School. And these were through difficult years, particularly Annadale. But children always went to school, no matter how disturbed it had been the night. We'd often been up a couple of times during the night because of a raid. And I think it's something we've lost, that the will to go out and do it. Perhaps I'm not saying we should have bombing again, but the young people, I think, should understand the need to be a bit more aware why we should be doing things. And I made a real mess up of that, I know, but I'm sure you've got the... So, just like to thank those who have supported my nomination. I'm very grateful to you, and look forward to it afterwards when we have a... I take it there's going to be a drink afterwards, is there? Sorry. I know times are hard, but no doubt there will be a drink. So thank you very much again, Mr. Mayor and Madam Mayoress. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Our third recipient is also a past mayor and former councillor, Janet Gilman. And can I ask Councillor Denise Highland to move the recommendation, please?
Yes, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, Mr. Mayor, of course. Well, Janet Gilman. Lord and Lady Charlton tonight, to their friends. Well, I met Janet when I got on the council in 2006, and Janet was chair of Health and Scrutiny panel that I served on. And Janet was incredibly hardworking, as people like Claire will attest to, because we were on that panel together, and has made a real difference, I think, in championing good health, and was at the beginning of so many of the strategies that we now employ in our borough. So thank you for all the work you've done for this borough, Janet. You are a bit like a stick of rock. If we cut you in half, it would say Greenwich right the way through, wouldn't it? But she has been an absolute inspiration to all of us. And particularly, I'd say, to women and women counsellors. Janet has that magnificent balance between being a serious player and also has that wonderful sense of humour that takes people with her and exudes love and confidence and peace and joy to all. But you're a real giggler. And there have been many occasions when we've sat and rocked and just giggled at goodness knows what. Janet is a serious pioneer as a woman councillor here in Greenwich. She's been a supporter of the Cooperative Party well before she got involved in the Labour Party. She is a huge supporter of town twinning, and all credit to you for all the work that's been done on town twinning. And we have Frank Zemke here from Rheinickendorf and Berlin. Thank you, Frank, for making the journey over. Janet has done enormous amounts of work for charity. Who can forget her annual breast cancer awareness mornings, where she's done coffee and cake every year at Charlton House and actually engaged an awful lot of people in that fundraising for Macmillan. Who could forget the day, John, that I tipped a bucket of ice water over you in the ice bucket challenge, which you, being the good sport you are, took so well, and that raised so much money. I'm afraid I've yet to be, you know, reciprocated, but I have to arrange that sometime soon. But Janet, you know, you have a list as long as your arm too. Mayor, Deputy Mayor, Vice Chair of Women's Committee, you've represented Horne Fair and Charlton, Area Planning, the Council Executive, you've played your part in Housing and in Leisure, and in Personnel Appeals Committee, Probity and Conduct. You have been extraordinary, and tonight we honour you, all of us here tonight. Thank you.
I would now like to invite Councillor Anna McCarthy to come up and second the recommendation.
Thank you once again, Mr. Mayor. I mean, you can't do Jim without doing Janet, and I'm so pleased to be able to second this proposal tonight. Janet works very quietly at what she does, and it's not always obvious that she's done anything at all until you find out later. And sometimes you don't find out, sometimes she doesn't know you found out, but you don't let on. But she does a massive amount of things other than being the council in her past. And she and I were co-councillors for 8 years, and we've been on Cherry Orchard Governors together since I went back, but you've been on Cherry Orchard Governors for 6 head teachers, is it? Or 7? I think it a long time. She's just a lovely person to work with. Janet's family, I'm pleased to say, like mine on my father's side, came to Charlton from Ireland. And I've never known why they came, but I know where they came to because she told me. There is, however, a difference. Yours has been in Charlton longer than mine, and mine have been in Charlton since the early 1930s. So your connection is great for the borough and for the Charlton community in particular. And it's in Charlton, as a child, that Janet started her work with the community and helping them. As a small girl, and their home on the Woolwich Road near the dog track, which is now Macrose, you looked after bikes for people who came to football matches. They did that in those days. I mean, they came to football matches. They're not doing that very much at the moment, but in those days it was a big issue. And you looked after the bikes, and to make sure that they got the right bike back, you had a system with raffle tickets. And I think that is not only where she learnt the art of being involved in the community, it's where she also learnt the art of order and method and everything, because her minutes are wonderful, wonderful. And your connection with the community has been that long as well, all the way through. I've mentioned Cherry Orchard School, and the leader has kindly mentioned a number of other places, but you've had the community organisations, the Her Centre, the Talking Newspapers, where you're a volunteer reader, St Luke's Almshouses, Charlton Triangle, the News Friends, New Leaf Centre, Friends Groups. You support people, you support the community. It's what you do. And what you do well. Once you'd retired from the council, you turned your hand to horticulture and proceeded to win the prize for her dahlias, which were very splendid dahlias as well. And when I tried to find out, are there any Janet stories about, I didn't get very far. One person looked at me completely bemused, totally blank. Janet, he said, there aren't any embarrassing stories about Janet. She's always so distinguished. And I think that's true. I haven't actually meant any embarrassing stories. I just wondered any little anecdotes. But I think that actually said it. She's always so distinguished. I've canvassed with Janet, obviously. I remember one occasion, someone came to the door, and before you went into the spiel bit, looked across, saw her and said, oh, hello, Janet. Yeah, of course, I'll be there for you. She's known just by being there. Another time, canvassing on my own, I knocked on a door, a lady came to it, and I did my little spiel. And said, she looked at me and said, I'm really sorry. And I said, oh, fair enough. She said, I do vote Labour, but I only ever vote for Janet. And I said, you can vote for me and somebody else as well. And no, I only ever vote for Janet. And that is the kind of arrangement. She does have this sort of persona underway. In fact, not only did Jim's get as far as Brighton, Janet's has gone still further than that. During the period, I think it was your first period as mayor, President Putin, no less, came to the area originally to go and see the statue of Peter the Great at Deptford. But he changed his mind. He came to the observatory instead. I think he wanted to meet Janet. He'd heard about her, and nothing will cause me to think otherwise. Now, I spoke earlier when I introduced the item, the proposal rather, about Janet, about Jim, about this metaphor of the planets. Well, in our solar system, the planets that we see, we think of as stars. And I think Janet is one of our stars. Mr. Mayor, I am very, very pleased to second this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can I now ask the council to vote on the recommendation that past mayor and former councillor Janet Gilman is awarded the freedom of the borough. All those in favour, please raise their hand. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hand. I see none. Abstentions, I see none. Therefore, I'm pleased to declare the recommendation agreed. And I would now like to invite Janet to receive her award and to say a few words.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Councillors Highland and Councillor McCarthy, for those kind words. In 1994, when I was first elected to Greenwich Council, representing Hornfair and then Charlton wards, I felt really privileged to represent an area in which I live and had grown up, having attended a Charlton school, and where my children and grandchildren attended Charlton schools. And as Alan has mentioned, I also currently am a governor of a Charlton school. And also, as Alan said, my links with Charlton go back as far as my grandparents, who lived in a gaslit cottage opposite Charlton's Greyhound racetrack, which is now Macros, and they raised a family of 8 children. My grandfather, being a first-generation Irish immigrant, knew hard times back then, as did my own parents, raising a family during the war, when my father being overseas for a long time and my mother working in the Woolwich Arsenal. This was a situation so many families at that time found themselves in. I did, however, benefit from attending a nursery for working mothers, again in Charlton, and the nursery at that time was open from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. I'd like to think how proud my parents and grandparents would be this evening, and how anything is possible and achievable in the Royal Borough of Greenwich. I would like to thank councillors from all sides of the council chamber for the honour of the freedom of the borough, especially those who worked with me on my responsibility for health scrutiny. We worked closely with other boroughs over many months on the consultation of the reorganisation of the NHS in South East London. The consultation was called A Picture of Health, and I think some of us still bear the bruises of it. My mayoral years were also unforgettable, and I had the privilege to meet memorable people, the Queen and members of the royal family, and Valentina, the first woman in space, and all those countless groups of Greenwich heroes who volunteer in all sorts of ways to support the council services to residents in need. My time on the council was also a period of many achievements, hosting the 2012 Olympic events, the Best Council Award, much improved transport links, DLR and Jubilee Line, and of course the Royal Borough status. The council of all political persuasions worked hard for these achievements, as does the current council, and I wish them well. I would also like to pay tribute to all council officers, especially those on the front line of council services in these difficult times. Without their efforts and loyalty to the council and the borough's residents in these times of constraints on council services, the Royal Borough of Greenwich would not be what it is today. In my view, the best borough in London. Once again, I would like to thank you all for this unexpected honour. I will treasure it and this evening always. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Janet. We now move to the next recipient, Dr. Tariq Abbasi. Would Councillor Denise Highland please come forward and move the recommendation that Dr. Tariq Abbasi, MBE, is awarded the Freedom of the Borough, and I should also congratulate him on behalf of the Council on his election as Deputy Lieutenant.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Dr. Tariq Abbasi, MBE, has worked as an investment banker, a technical analyst, a real estate developer for the past 25 years. You know, he's also, within a week of us deciding to give him the freedom of this royal borough, he contacted me to say that the Queen had appointed him as Deputy Lord Lieutenant for Greater London, alongside, of course, Peter Vanderbilt. So we are truly spoilt to have Peter Vandermeer and Dr. Tarika Bassi as Queen's representatives here in the Borough of Greenwich. You know, in addition to running his own business, he has been serving as a trustee for several local, national, and international charitable organisations, supporting and advocating peace and justice. In addition, he has also assisted educating young children from underprivileged backgrounds. Tariq served as the director and a trustee of the Greenwich Islamic Centre here for over 2 decades and received his MBE in 2011 for tireless work with community cohesion in the Royal Borough of Greenwich and in Bexley. What was stunning about his work as director is that he always, always focused on community cohesion. He was a player with the Borough of Greenwich. He was there supporting us when times were hard. And at a very difficult time, he tackled very successfully radicalism and extremism by an organisation that has since been disbanded. It took enormous courage and wisdom and, frankly, guts to do what you did, Tariq, and we as a borough will always be very, very grateful to you for that. Tariq is Secretary General. That's a call for you right now, Tariq. The Queen is on the line. Tariq is Secretary General of the World Muslim Congress, which has a consultative status at the United Nations and an observer. Now, he currently sits on the Armed Forces Muslim Forum, which he is a founder of, and he also is on the Tell Mama Advisory Board, which I'm sure he will tell us a lot more about later, but essentially it's about countering anti-Muslim hate and Islamophobia. He is a supporter of very many charities that we are all aware of, and he is a recipient here in the Royal Borough of Greenwich for a Lifetime Achievement Award for his services to the community. As I said, he's been an integral part of our multi-faith community here in Greenwich. And when we had disturbances back in 2011, played a major part in calming the tensions, and at the same time also with the tragic murder of Lee Rigby. We have seen his football team playing up at the army barracks. We've seen the police working on cycle safety inside the mosque. We've seen him promote youth work inside the mosque for those young people and to give them a wider view of the world. In April 2015, he received a personal commendation from Sir Nicholas Houghton, the Chief of the Defence Staff, for services to the British Armed Forces. Tariq is that founder member of the Armed Forces Muslim Forum. Tariq is married to Zelina with 3 wonderful grown-up children. And you know that Greenwich has an international reputation now as a smart city Borough, and actually Tariq has a PhD in artificial intelligence, which when our shopping robots and our driverless cars are on the street, Tariq, we, you know, fully expect you to be involved in that. But above all, you know, you may have a PhD in artificial intelligence, but my goodness, you've got a great load in human intelligence and human empathy, and we thank you for being such a great friend to this borough. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I would now like to invite Councillor Harry Singh to second the recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It gives me really great privilege to second Dr. Tariq Abbasi for the freedom of the borough. It's a really difficult act to follow after Denise. And my speech, I was writing, it all went up in the air. And she said everything that's needed to be said. And I was scratching my head, what am I going to say now? And I will say, I've known Dr. Tariq Abbasi for over 15 years. And I know him, I think we really got together, really got closer when I became the mayor of this borough. And also, I knew about his, I got invited to the mosque number of times, so many times I've been down there. And the work he has done, especially with young people. And he's promoted, always promoted peace, harmony, wanting that we all should live together. One thing that really separates Dr. Tariq Abbasi from everyone, from the other people, other great candidates we have, he's the only person not born in this country, which is a really great achievement. He came to this country when he's 20 years old, and he's lived in this borough for 33 years. And you can imagine what he's managed to achieve. The person who lived in a village, no lights, nothing, and to come in this country, to be awarded Deputy Lieutenant, now Freedom of the Borough. It's a really great achievement. And it also sends a clear message to every other Muslim. Look, through hard work, this not just Muslim, to everyone else, through hard work you can achieve anything you want. And he's got a lovely family. My children call him Uncle Tariq. Uncle Tariq, Dr. Tariq Abbasi. What do you call Uncle? We don't use names. Which Uncle do you mean? You know, one in the Dr. Tariq, you know? And they always refer him to Uncle. To this day, my kids are growing up. They always refer him, is Dr. Tariq Abbasi going to be coming? Uncle Dr. Tariq Abbasi? What is he up to? And the thing is that I think he's also a great ambassador. He's been a great ambassador for this borough. When we needed him the most, when our freedom was attacked globally, and he was the first person to come out, look, this isn't the Muslim community. This isn't the way of the Muslim. And he actually attacked those terrorists. This isn't our way. Our way is to live in peace, in harmony with everyone else. And that's what he's promoting. And the other thing really is through his hard work, is when we have when they have the Eid prayers, it's the biggest gathering in Royal Artillery. Over 10,000 Muslim from this borough and the neighboring borough attend for the prayer session. And after the prayer session, people are actually fed. So that's a really great achievement as well. So, and Dr. Tariq Abbasi, his service to the community, and it's been a trustee for many organizations, and especially being the director of a Greenwich Islamic Center. And the thing is, people forget, he raised about £3 million through his network of his contact. The thing is, that's a really great achievement. It's a small amount, but Andy still continues to do great work in this borough. And he is a dear friend to me. I would call him as a friend. The thing is that we really get on well with each other, and it gives me the great honour to nominate Dr. Tariq Abbasi for the freedom of the borough.
Thank you. Can I now ask the Council to vote on the recommendation that Dr. Tariq Abbasi, MBE, is awarded the freedom of the borough? All those in favour, please raise their hand. Thank you. All those against, please raise their hands. I see none. Any abstentions? I see none. I'm therefore pleased to declare the recommendation agreed. And I would now like to invite Dr. Tariq Abbasi to receive his award and to say a few words.
Mr. Mayor, Deputy Lieutenant, Lord and Lady Sheikh, Excellencies, Members of Parliament, Member of GLA, Leader of a great borough, councillors, borough commander, officers from our armed forces, free men, past mayors, friends, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening and Assalamu Alaikum. I'm extremely delighted, humbled and honoured to be recipient of the Freedom of the Borough of the Royal Borough of Greenwich. I really can't express how grateful I am to have you all of you with us this evening. I'd like to thank our Mayor, the Leader and the Cabinet members who supported and thought that I was worthy of receiving this honour. Thank you. Wonderful to hear our Leader Denise and Harry saying good words. I don't know whether I deserve them, but thank you so much. I'm humbled. Thank you. It is a tall order, really, for me, a man like 4 feet nothing, but I am really, truly humbled this evening. My daughter was telling me, Dad, you're going to get the freedom card tonight. I said, I beg your pardon. You know, I'm sorry. It's not a freedom card, at least not yet. And I told her this is our own version of actually the Oscars. In fact, better than the Hollywood Oscars, because those Oscars held every year. And whereas ours, the Royal Borough of Greenwich, are extremely unique and rare. And unlike theirs, ours are awarded without any discrimination. I am especially grateful to a few amazing bunch of people in my life whose support actually is the reason I'm up here this evening. Over the past 2.5 decades, I've spent a lot of time away from my family. And the time I took away from my family, I shared that amongst various charities. And for that, I'd like to thank my wife and children for being a good and continuous support. Thank you. One of the acts which is actually loved most by Almighty God is not really our prayers and fasting and all that. It is when one human being helps another fellow human being in need, and unconditionally, without any strings attached. Even if it's just a simple call to someone elderly or someone unwell, and perhaps a little help with their daily chores. And when we actually, all of us volunteers, give time to the charities, it is not the time we give. It is actually a piece of life we give away every time we spend 10 minutes, 30 minutes, 20 minutes, one day with the charity. It is actually piece of and portion of our life we have given to them, and which we never get back. This is why this act of helping others is extremely important and most loved by Almighty God. And charity work is extremely rewarding because upper hand is always better than the lower hand. A big thank you to Lord and Lady Sheikh, who actually who cancelled this afternoon's meeting, and they are here with us tonight. And many of my friends, actually, they came from out of London also. And His Excellency Dr. Samir also, and Abdulaziz came from Riyadh and Istanbul. So many friends from all over the place. I can't go without mentioning how sad I feel on the tragic lives of the lives in Belgium yesterday. Nothing but an appalling and barbaric attack on the innocent civilians. I can condemn that in the strongest terms. And now it reminds me that how hard our armed forces actually and our police force and the other emergency services work to make sure that we are safe. So this evening, I'd like to actually dedicate this Freedom of the Bar Award to the people who sacrificed their lives for us, for Britain, so that we may continue enjoying our freedom. Lee Rigby was brutally murdered in 2013, and his freedom was taken away by two criminals of our society. And in armed forces, if you look at the history, the Khudad Khan was the first Muslim soldier who was awarded Victoria Cross for his bravery. And in addition to his, there were 400,000 other Muslims who fought in the First World War, which we never talk about, the unsung heroes. And I just want to congratulate actually Dermot and Jim, Janet, and Chris, of course, he's still got to come, becoming a fellow freeman of the Bar of Granite. But before I go, just a little message to our local friends that if you see something lurking around tonight, you know, in the streets of Woolwich, don't bother calling the police. It'll be probably me and my sheep. Thank you ever so much. Thank you.
Tariq, thank you very much. Our final recipient this evening is former councillor Chris Roberts. And can I therefore ask Councillor Steve Offord to come forward and move the recommendation, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and distinguished guests, and Deputy Lieutenants. It's good to be here tonight, and an amazing privilege to have heard all about these different people who've made their significant contribution to this Royal Borough over the years. Everybody here is probably here to support one or other of the people who've been receiving the freedom. And I'm sure you've all been extremely impressed to hear about the other people tonight who are also receiving the freedoms. I have to say about Dermot, because I can remember now in 1968 sitting in the public hall doing the count for the election, and the shock and horror on the faces of the successful Conservative candidates at that election, when not only Horn Park but also Woolwich Common went Conservative. So Dermot, we do go back a very long way, and very grateful for all the support you've given me over the years. Anyway, every now and again a politician comes along who makes a step change in the fortunes of a council and the residents who live in that borough. And Chris Roberts is one of those. I first encountered Chris Roberts in the late 90s when he surprised many people by being elected leader of this historic borough against good quality opposition. I'm not sure if the opposition's actually present here tonight, but they're probably not far away. Prior to this, for several years, the prime objective of the council, then ably led by Len Duval, was to achieve a financial strategy which was rigorous and strategic. Chris continued to embed this up to the present time, However, he then began to move the borough forward to repair the catastrophic unemployment that had followed decades of decline of the industries along the river, which were for so long the source of work for so many residents of our borough. This was no overnight achievement and relied on his single-minded dedication to a long-term programme of renewal and regeneration for the council. This did not come without cost to Chris, as he would work all hours, far too many hours, and frequently his health would suffer. He never sought popularity, and this led to regular criticism in the media and elsewhere. Despite this, he never lost his will to succeed in his objectives. He'd be the first to point out that the progress in Greenwich during his time as leader was not his and his alone. He was fortunate to have the support of a series of cabinet colleagues, chief officers, and a chief executive in Mary Ney who matched his support and his approach. The designation of Greenwich as a royal borough, the recognition as Borough of the Year, and a leading role for Greenwich in the 2012 Olympic Games, again up against much opposition, all proved great successes. But most significantly of all, his vision that development, and particularly that of new housing, would bring rewards have proved true. Not just in improving the fortunes of borough residents with jobs, but ensuring income generation for the council that have enabled improvements in the sporting, cultural, and community safety services at a time of significant reductions in government grant. Not just this government, but also previous governments. His personal drive and determination to ensure the arrival of the DLR and Crossrail stations in Woolwich finally justified the decision made all those years ago when Woolwich was designated as the borough's strategic centre. Chris Roberts played a central role in winning these transport improvements, which are recognised as integral to the viability of any town centre. One of his less known interests has been to cement the borough's twinning with Rhein-Neckendorf in Germany. And as Denise was saying, Frank is here tonight from Rhein-Neckendorf. It's so much so that the council there have already awarded him the freedom of their borough. He said to me once that the goal of a politician is not just to win elections, but it's what you achieve once you've done so. So, Mr. Mayor, I'm honoured to nominate Chris Roberts as a Freeman of the Royal Borough of Greenwich. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I would now like to invite Councillor John Fahey to second the recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, Deputy Lieutenant, Madam Mayoress, lords and ladies, distinguished guests, fellow councillors, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to second the nomination of Chris Roberts for the freedom of the borough. When I was preparing my short statement, I was under the misguided impression that in circumstances of this occasion, that I would have the last word, but having listened to all the other recipients, I've obviously got that wrong. The Freedom of the Borough, as the Mayor has pointed out, is the highest award that the Council can bestow and dates back to 1885. It is a power rarely used and is normally only awarded to local people who have, in the opinion of the Council, rendered eminent services to the Borough. In all respects, Chris has fully deserves to be recognised by this council for his outstanding contribution to the borough, as Councillor Offord has so eloquently highlighted. He has left behind a legacy that future generations will look back upon with enormous pride. He remained focused on his objective, whether it was about securing financial stability or securing the growth agenda, which has become the envy of neighbouring boroughs. His single-minded approach was not always universally welcomed by colleagues who sat in the room. And Chris and I and others have sat in a number of rooms across London where those discussions were, to say the least, interesting. Whether it was ministers of state, leader colleagues, or whatever, or whoever was frustrating the Greenwich project, were not excused lightly. His ambition, as Councillor Offord has pointed out, to secure the Olympic legacy can be seen all around the borough. There are many stories which we all know of his single-mindedness and passion, but I suspect time doesn't permit us to highlight all those this evening, but I suspect at some time in the future we shall have to wait for the publication of his memoirs. However, Mr. Mayor, I vividly remember our time in Beijing on two occasions prior to the Olympic Games, when walking across through Beijing to a park where a pre-Olympic event was taking place, when we all spotted a very large queue of people with their money in hand wanting to get into the park to pay for their outdoor exercise. Lo and behold, some months later, on our return to Greenwich, the outdoor gyms became a reality and are now widely used across the borough. As each day, each week passed, something new was emerging. The energy, the passion was always there, and I look back with enormous pleasure that those of us around at the time shared in that experience. It has always been difficult to explain to those taking a limited interest in town hall affairs how much time and effort is required to maximize the opportunities that emerge day in and day out in public life. Chris, as Councillor Offord has remarked, left no stone unturned in driving the changes that we now see all around the borough. Tonight, we take the time and space to celebrate his achievements, and it gives me great pleasure to second the nomination. Thank you.
Can I now therefore ask the Council to vote on the recommendation that former Councillor Chris Roberts is awarded the Freedom of the Borough? All those in favour, please raise their hands. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hands. I see none. Any abstentions? I see none. I'm therefore pleased to declare the recommendation agreed. I would now like to invite Chris to say, or to receive his award and say a few words.
Well, Mr. Mayor, that's the only thing two Charlton fans are going to get their hands on this year. Steve, John, can I thank you for your very kind words? And can I just say before I start the formal bit of my speech, what an honour it is for me to be sharing this evening with Dermot, Jim, Janet and Tariq. I'm always a bit nervous when Dermot starts to mention your name. It's like a cold steel blade slowly being lifted metaphorically out of its cover to be sharpened and in debate, metaphorically poked right between your eyes. But we've both moved on now, Dermot, and so I'm very grateful for your kind words. Mr. Mayor, councillors and friends, first of all, thank you. And thank you especially to the councillors for your decision to award me the Freedom of the Borough. It is greatly appreciated, and I shall always view it with great humility. I shall always view it as a shared award. Yes, I was the leader of a council, but I was the front man for a majority of the borough's councillors across all parties, for thousands of council workers and school staff, and the countless partners with whom we worked. I'm delighted so many are here this evening and regret that so many, of course, cannot be. But wherever they may be, I hope that they will all take pride in what we achieved, because whatever was achieved was done so collectively. Now, John has referred to a few things, and I know that the pace we set was sometimes uncomfortable, but we made some fairly big omelets, so we broke quite a lot of eggs, or at least I did. But we set out to move at pace, because we inherited the worst attaining schools in the country, the second highest council tax in London, a shortage of homes, and high levels of crime. So the pace of delivery, in my judgment, was crucial. So when my leadership election was met by one of my colleagues deciding to put his nose in my face, jab me in the shoulder and pronounce, "You may have won the battle, but we're going into opposition," I felt I had two choices. One was to decide to allow the majority group to turn inward and debate and fight amongst itself, or the other was to energise the overwhelming majority and deliver the change we needed for the people of Greenwich. We had a clear vision of what could be achieved if we could transform the areas of dereliction left by the end of industry on our waterfront. 150,000 jobs lost, 62% male unemployment in the old Arsenal ward, which was the highest in Great Britain at the time, and as I have said, the worst education results in all of England and Wales. There was little hope, a poverty of aspiration, and no inward investment. But I was blessed with a wonderful management team led by an exceptional chief executive in Mary Ney, but which included a collection of outstanding public servants on a senior management team of David McCollum, Chris Perry, John Comber, George Guite, David Behan, John Navroshki, Gillian Palmer, Debbie Warren, John Clark, and Katrina Delaney. To them were added some incredibly dynamic and committed partners. Kevin Fuster, Roy Clare, and Peter van der Merwe at the National Maritime Museum, the borough deans and faith leaders, and you've heard from Tariq as just one of them this evening, the army and the police, Jane Schofield at the Primary Care Trust, Richard Doughty at the Cutty Sark, Cyril Young, and now Peter again in their roles as deputy lieutenants. In the private sector, Tony Pidgley and John Anderson of Barclay Homes, who invested in this borough when no one else would, and who kept building homes when the recession hit and when many others had stopped. David Campbell and Rebecca Kane at the O2, Steve Nelson from the Chamber of Commerce, and Mark Sesnan and Peter Bundy at GLL, Jason Morgan, Steve Sutherland and Peter Varney at Charlton, and even Lord Stirling. Now, some of my erstwhile colleagues may have found his past politics as rather unedifying. As a trade unionist, I certainly did. But I tell you this, he brought scores of millions of pounds into this borough, and without him, the Cutty Sark would not be what it was today. There would be no southeast wing of the National Maritime Museum, and this borough would not be a royal borough. There are times when you have to put politics aside and just say, the guy delivered for our borough. Among councillors, there are so many, and almost too many to mention, so I'm not going to. Apart from, I have to mention my deputy leader of 12 years in Peter Brooks, and also Jim Gilman, for two reasons. One, when I won a very, very narrow victory in the leadership election, it was Jim who joined me as deputy leader to help bring and unify the group together. But it was also Jim who told me in 1994, when I was standing for the council and I thought about withdrawing my nomination, to just stick with it. So actually, you can all blame it on Jim. So my profound thanks to all of them and the many, many others I just do not have the time to mention. Together we raised school standards from the worst to a position where our results are now in the highest quartile across the country. Together we granted planning permission for 40,000 new homes in this borough, and through our local labour scheme put 18,700 people into work. We brought the Olympics, the tall ships, the Red Bull Air Race, along with the Tour de France and the London Regatta. And we froze the council tax for 9 years in a row and became Council of the Year. So my thanks to all here and all who delivered on that agenda. Now, Mr. Mayor, they don't give leaving dues to councillors. And I think that's probably right. But over the years, I have watched chief officers retire, thank their staff, make their speeches, and then make special mention of their personal staff. So as much as it will embarrass them, I'd like to publicly say thank you to Veronica Johnson and Sophie Lewis. However effective or efficient I was, it was down to them. And when I wasn't, it was not for their want of trying. And I'd like to ask them to come up and receive a small gift from me, please. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to end with a quote, if I may. You are not here merely to make a living. You are here to enable the world to live more amply, with greater vision, and with a finer spirit of hope and achievement. You are here to enrich the world. You impoverish yourself if you forget this errand. Mr. Mayor, I'm pleased, proud, and was privileged to work with so many people who felt that way. And thank you once again for this award.
Thank you, Chris, and thanks to all of you for attending tonight. That concludes the business of tonight's special meeting. And I'd like to invite everyone to come upstairs to the reception in the committee suite upstairs in front of you. I will return if the three persons of the borough and their families and friends wish to have photographs taken on steps, as it were, as is the tradition here. So thank you very much for your attendance and enjoy yourselves upstairs.